Hello, this is Solar PVTV from EU PVSEC 2016. Once again, with the guest from far, far, far away from the United States, with Professor Vasilis Fthenakis. Kalimera, Vasilis.
Kalimera.
Vasilis, it's quite interesting that you are coming to EU PVSEC from the United States. So what is actually the reason?
I haven't missed a meeting over the last perhaps 10 or 12 years because primarily of the networking and also so many good ideas, results of research that I presented. But it's primarily because the growth of photovoltaics started in Europe, in Germany, and I have been very close with the European Photovoltaic Industry Association as the industry has been growing.
And what is your now major activity? I remember that in the past you were cooperating also with EPI, with Solar Power Europe, on the recycling topics, on the sustainability topics. And I would like to know what is now your major, let's say, scope of work at the university, but also in different bodies, because you are a member of different bodies related to sustainability.
The overall theme remains sustainability. And my research is focusing on topics at the interface of energy and the environment. Mm-hmm. So recycling, for example, where I was now in the workshop this afternoon, is related to sustainability at the end of the life, because with recycling, we could have photovoltaics that would be less expensive years into the future.
And also double green.
Double green, environmental impact, and also having a secondary resource of materials like tellurium, indium, germanium, gallium,
exactly.
That they are expected,
yes.
Exactly, expected to pick. But that's one actually aspect of my work, one topic of my work. The other is life cycle analysis, looking into the whole life, not only the end, but also the beginning, what is called cradle to grave. So from materials from the mining operations into the refining, the manufacturing of the cells, the modules, the installation and so on, and establishing the profile, the environmental profile of the industry to compare with other power generation. And the third one has to do with systems integration, how PV, because they are fluctuating and intermittent, they can interact with the grid. And perhaps a new, that is a fourth one, but is again within the overall sustainability issue, is the water energy nexus, looking into photovoltaics.
With no CO2.
With no CO2. For example, water desalination, fresh water or brackish water using solar energy, both photovoltaics and solar thermal, but photovoltaics has actually the highest potential because of the low cost to produce water through reverse osmosis or electrodialysis, that they need a lot of electricity, and photovoltaics can provide this without CO2 emissions.
And this, I think, a program is supported by the French government and also Abu Dhabi, yes?
Yes, it was launched actually in Paris in December, mm-hmm. during the COP21, supported by those two governments, and there are many, many industrial partners there, including some big ones like Up and Go, and I think Dow and DuPont. I was elected in the board, 20-member board, and we're expecting many things to happen out of this alliance.
And this is very interesting, yeah, yes. Because it's not all solar, it's not only about the energy, but it's also the water, which actually today maybe is even more crucial issue than just energy suppliers.
Absolutely. It actually tackles both of those issues. I mean, one is that the thermoelectric generation with fossil fuel use a lot of water. Photovoltaics do not. Mm-hmm. And we have the need for desalination, either brackish or waste water or seawater, and it is abundant because many areas become more arid. And a half of the cost, it is energy cost there. So having photovoltaics making actually more affordable electricity, and obviously not...
We are recently reporting from Dubai and from Abu Dhabi, and there are already systems who are which are working, including solar installations, yeah, for the water resources.
Actually, they have one of the lowest LCOEs, their levelized cost of electricity, something like 5.8 cents per kilowatt hour. Mm-hmm. And obviously, they're very sunny. Electricity will be less expensive than other areas. There is also big interest on water desalination. It just started being immersed in north of Chile. For where we have in modern times the first water desalination plant, I think in 1872, with solar thermal. And the mining operations...
Before PV was so expensive.
Exactly, exactly. And the mining operations need water there, so we have actually a new water desalination using photovoltaics, some prototypes, and we expect that the business...
So interesting business model, yeah, and appliance.
Absolutely. It is a new industry. One perhaps of the several new industries that are being created because of photovoltaics getting more affordable. The other storage, I mean, you mentioned cars, batteries. There is a renewed interest into battery research and development because in addition to the cars, you have also more stationary applications. Since it helps very much with photovoltaics being very inexpensive.
And I would like to ask you another question. I liked very much your remark that you were coming to Europe because Europe was always in the past the leader, yes, in innovation, yeah, even in the industry and also even in the market growth, yeah, with the German feed-in tariff especially. And you are not from Europe, yes? We were discussing with some European speakers. They were quite concerned that Europe is a bit slowing down right now. And people are a bit concerned about the European leadership in the future. What is your opinion on this? Because you are also, I think, with European roots, yes, Vasilis?
Oh, yes. Actually, I was born and educated in Greece before I came to the United States, continued my education, and stayed in the United States for the last probably 40 years. I think what is happening is natural. Actually, I think the Europeans were ahead, at least of the Americans, in terms of being conscious and conscientious about the environment. But it is all natural that most of the growth will happen in high irradiation regions, and perhaps the south of Europe, but although the economists perhaps they're not allowing this at this point. So it's moving gradually into the high radiation areas like the southwest of the United States, north of Chile, the Gulf countries. It's all natural. But I think that Europe will be a co-leader in the years ahead because there is a lot more potential in Europe as well. Maybe not innovation, absolutely, and perhaps in terms of then through innovation into manufacturing. I mean, Europe used to be the number one importer of yes. photovoltaics. It can become the number one exporter with innovation, and there's still room for more installations in several countries, especially in the south, perhaps not as much as in areas that they have not seen high deployment before. So it's all natural. So I wouldn't think that Europe won't be a leader any longer, won't be the main leader, but I think we'll be in the leadership.
Cool.
Right.
And what do you think, Vasilis, about the new trends? So before we were only speaking about PV, now we are speaking about, let's say, solar plus storage solution. And how does it, what is your feeling about this?
If we don't have storage, or if we don't have some kind of combination of photovoltaics with other renewable energies, then the maximum penetration, depending on the region of the grid, could be from 10, 20 to 30%. It's very, very difficult to get more than 30% with only PV generation. So we wanted to get it to 60, 70, 100% eventually. And this can be done with a combination of renewable energies.
So you believe in 100%?
I do believe in 100%, or almost 100%, perhaps aerospace with the current technology. Could be, it's not in that 100% because we need very, very high energy, actually intensive fuels, but with hydrogen and or some other kind of fuel, eventually we could get to 100%. But it's not difficult to get to the 60-70% with a combination of photovoltaics with wind and with some storage. Now, smart, actually, introduction of storage. We don't want every kilowatt hour from PV generation to go into batteries, would be too expensive. But we take into account the geographical diversity, and we have time zones and so on. For example, PV from the southwest is actually lagging about 3 hours with the electricity demand in the northeast. Mm-hmm. So high voltage DC current and the combination of wind and photovoltaics would do a lot of this towards the 70% that we are
hiring. It may be 100, yeah.
It may be 100. But at some point, you need the storage. Mm-hmm. And so optimization of storage, in order to minimize this, it is a part of what several actually entities are doing, including us at Columbia.
So thank you so much, Vasilis, and I appreciate that you spent time with us, especially, you know, after this long trip, and you look so great, you know, even the jet lag. And I hope that we'll meet you also next year at EU PVSEC and maybe also in the United States. Thank you so much.
It was a pleasure, Thomas, and I hope that we will keep a meeting too. There's actually so many things happening year after year. Yeah. So having a chance to talk about what is happening with you, it is really a treat. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was Solar PV TV with one of the sustainability leaders from the United States, with his European heart from Greece, with Vasilis Fthenakis. Thanks for watching.